وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى. We're now going to go to the second part in our series القواعد الفقهية المتعلقة بالمعاملات المالية Legal Maxims of Islamic Jurisprudence related to financial transaction. As I mentioned in our last lesson, we spoke about the introduction. We spoke about three things. Al-Qawa'id Al-Fiqhiyya, what it means, and its reality, and that which is related to it. Number two, we spoke about Al-Mu'amalat. And the third thing that we spoke about was Al-Maliyya. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to start the first qaida, the first legal maxim, the first principle. The way that I plan, inshallah ta'ala, to go through today's lesson is in the following way, inshallah ta'ala. Number one, I'm going to mention the principle. The first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to mention the principle. I'm going to mention the first qa'ida fiqhiyya, the first legal maxim that relates to financial transaction. Once I mention the first principle, and once I mention the first qa'ida, I will define the terms that are in the qa'ida. The terms and the words that are in the principle, that are in the qa'ida, I will define it inshallah ta'ala. That's the second thing I'm going to do. Number three, I'm going to mention the benefit in which it holds this particular qa'ida. What benefit does it have? What's the benefit in knowing this particular qa'ida? And what benefit will it bring you? Number four, what's the meaning of this qa'ida, the overall meaning and the overall understanding that we can take from this qa'ida? That is the fourth point, inshallah ta'ala. Number five, adillatul qa'ida, the evidence for this particular principle. What evidence does it stand on? Is there any evidence that backs it? And the way that I plan to do the evidence is in two ways. Adilla juz'iyya, I'm going to mention specific evidences. That's called adilla juz'iyya. And also adilla kulliyya, comprehensive evidences that support this qa'ida. So adilla juz'iyya is going to be al-kitab wa sunnah wa al-ijma'ah. And adillatul kulliyya is going to be other qa'ida that support this qa'ida. And they're going to be three qa'ida, inshallah ta'ala. The adillatul kulliyya, the comprehensive principle, but the comprehensive evidences are going to be principles. And they're going to be three, inshallah ta'ala. So you have three adillah juz'iyya and three adillah kulliyya. After that, inshallah ta'ala, the sixth point, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, I'm going to mention ba'd al-buyu' al-muta'alliqa, some financial transaction that are connected to this qa'ida. These financial transactions are going to be prominent, contemporary financial transaction that we today know and see, that are connected to this principle that we're going to be mentioning. And I've chosen three, inshallah ta'ala, The first one is bay'u al-taqsit and bay'u al-murabaha and also bay'u al-aswum. Those are the three, inshallah ta'ala. I will explain what each one means, inshallah ta'ala. Bay'u al-taqsit, translation-wise, is the transaction of paying something in installments. Number two, bay'u al-murabaha. Bay'u al-murabaha is placing profit on a known amount of money of a product. You take it and you place a additional profit onto it and you sell it to someone. We'll explain that in more details what it means. The third one is bay'u al-aswum. Bay'u al-aswum is buying shares in companies. Those are the three, inshallah ta'ala, that we're going to be talking about when it comes to the buyu' al-mu'asara, the contemporary financial transaction that are connected to this principle, inshallah ta'ala. That's the way that I will be going around, well, that's the way I will be having the lesson today, inshallah ta'ala. So let's get ready, bi-idhnillah al-kareem, and let's keep in mind that today, inshallah ta'ala, as it's the first day for the principle starting and the qawa'id starting, we're only going to take one. Because this one is very, very generic and it's very, very big. And in total, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to be taking 11 qa'idah. We're going to be taking 11 qa'idah, meaning we're taking 11 principles. So today we're only going to take one. And then after that, we're going to be trying to take more than one, inshallah ta'ala. So al-qa'idah al-ula, the first principle is الأصل في البيوع الإباحة. The first قاعدة is الأصل في البيوع الإباحة. So I've mentioned what the قاعدة is. الأصل في البيوع الإباحة. The first قاعدة is الأصل في البيوع الإباحة. So point number one is mentioning the principle. I've mentioned what the principle is. I'm going to move on to the second point that I said I would do, which is I'm now going to define the terms that are in the principle. We have two words that we don't know so far, which is al-asl and al-ibaha. We know what buyu' means. We took it in the introduction. What does asl mean, lughatan wa istilahan? What does it mean linguistically and what does it mean technically? The word al-asl. Al-asl, linguistically, it means asfalu shay'i, the lowest thing. وَهُوَ مَا يَنْبَنِي عَلَيْهِ غَيْرُهُ وَهُوَ مَا يَنْبَنِي عَلَيْهِ شَيْءٍ. It is whatever things are built upon. وَمَا يَتَفَرَّعُ عَنْهُ شَيْءٍ. And it is what things spring from. It is what things come from. That's what asl means fil lugha, in the language. So that's why we say, as Allah mentioned in the Quran, subhanahu wa ta'ala, alam tara kayfa daraba Allahu mathalan kalimatan tayyibatan kashajaratin tayyibatin asluha thabit wa far'uha fis sama'. Asluha thabit, its foundation is strong. وَفَرْعُهَا, the sub-branches that come from it are what? In the sky. The asl here is meant by لا إله إلا الله. That's the asl. And everything is built upon that. That's what it means في اللغة, in the language. That's what it means in the language. The asl means the foundation. The foundation of this house that we're in right now is the asl, and everything else is built upon it. What does al-asl mean fi lisan al-ulama, according to the scholars? The scholars, when they use the word asl, What do they mean by it? Kalimatul asl, the term asl, عند العلماء, according to the scholars, لها معاني, it has many meanings. The scholars, they have so many meanings in the word al-asl, when they use it. There's no one particular meaning. It's more than one. The first one is, I'm only going to mention five of them. The first one is al-rajih. One of the meanings is al-rajih. Al-rajih means the strongest. لذلك they say الأصل في الكلام الحقيقة. الأصل في الكلام الحقيقة. The أصل in a person's speech is that it is literal. Okay? It is literal. And that is not metaphorical. Here it means الراجح. راجح means there's a مرجوح. Times can happen that the person's speech is not haqiqa, it is majaz. There are times it can be metaphor. But the strongest is that, or this weight is more towards what? The haqiqa. So if we say 100%, 60 or 70% is that the speech is haqiqa, unless there comes a external evidence and it indicates that it's not upon the haqiqa meaning. So here they mean al-rajah. Number two is al-dalil. Number two is al-dalil, evidence. They use the word al-asl as dalil. ولذلك they say, al-asl fi al-mas'ala al-kitab wa-sunnah. The asl in the mas'ala is al-kitab and sunnah. Meaning the dalil in this issue is al-kitab wa sunnah. Also the third meaning that it's used as is al-istishab. Istishab means biqa' ma kana ala ma kana. It's letting something remain in the way that it is. The scholars, they mention that. It's ta'arud al-asli wa al-tari. It's to let something upon its default position. Number five is al-maqisu alayhi. When we speak about, in the chapter of qiyas, we mentioned that qiyas has four pillars. Al-aslu, wal-fara, wal-illa, wal-hukm. Al-asl meaning the thing that we're going to do the analogy from. If you want to do analogy, if you want to do qiyas, qiyas stands on four pillars, and if these four pillars are there, present, your qiyas is sahih. Or else your qiyas is what? Fasid. So you have to have an asl. You have to have a asl. And then you have a fara', which is the thing that you're using the qiyas for. And number three is, you have to have a illa, the reasoning why the asl was prohibited. And then you have to then find that illa present in the fara', and so you can give them both the same ruling, which is hukum. So here the asl is what? Al-maqisu alayhi, is the thing that you're going to do the qiyas from. Let me give you an example. Allah prohibited khamar. Khamar is the asl now. We have the asl here for us right now that we have the evidence for is what? Khamar. We now know drugs came out. The drug is the farah. What was the reason why Allah tabarak wa ta'ala prohibited khamar? Al-iskar, intoxication. That's the illa, then the third point. Okay, what's the hukum? The hukum is, first of all, is that illa that is present in the asl, is it also present in the farah? Is present in the khamar, we know that because Allah stated that. Is it also present in the drugs? Yes, it is. Then we say that the hukum and the ruling between the two of them is prohibition. So here the maqisu alayhi, the one that we're doing the analogy from, is called asl. So this is Qul al-Maqisu alayhi. Number 5. Al-Qa'ida al-Mustamirra. Al-Qa'ida al-Mustamirra means the continuous principle. The continuous principle. Are you there? The Qa'ida al-Mustamirra means the continuous principle. That's the fifth meaning that they use the word al-Asl for. What does that mean? It means, for example, al-Aslu fi akli al-Maytah. The Asl in eating corpse of dead animals is prohibition. Here it means that is the Qa'ida al-Mustamirra. The continuous principle is that it's prohibited. But there are times it's permissible. There are times when you are allowed to eat from it. Like in the qa'idatul mustamirra, the continuous principle is that you are not allowed to eat dead animals. You're not allowed to eat corpse. Here, which of those five do we mean in this qa'idah al-aslu fil buyu'i libaha? Which of the five does asl mean here? Asl here means the fifth one, which is al-qa'idatul mustamirra. The continuous principle. So here we mean al-qa'idatul mustamirra fil buyu'il ibaha. So al-asl here, when we say it, well, what are we trying to say? We're trying to say, if you get rid of the word al-asl and you exchange it with al-qa'idatul mustamirra, it will be what? Al-qa'idatul mustamirra fil buyu'il ibaha. That the continuous Qa'ida is in financial transaction is permissibility. Before I move on to the meaning of the word al-ibaha, what's the benefit of studying the asl of things? What's the benefit of learning? A lot of the times we hear the scholars, they say, and I mentioned even in the muqaddimah when I said al-asl fil awani al-tahara, the asl for utensils is what? Purification. Here the question is, scholars keep using that a lot. Is there a benefit in using that a lot? When they say al-aslu, qa'idatul mustamirra, is there a benefit? So I'm now going to mention, inshallah ta'ala, five benefits of using the term or the word al-aslu. And here when we say al-aslu, what do you mean? Al-Qa'idatul Mustamirra, we mean the continuous principle. I'm only going to mention five, there are more though. But here what's important for you to notice is that if Al-Aslu means Al-Qa'idatul Mustamirra, it means Qa'idatul Mustamirra, we already spoke about the benefits of studying Qa'idah. So it goes back to that point, kind of. Ala kulli hal, the first benefit is anything that falls under and ما يذكر تحت الأصل, anything that's mentioned under the أصل, under this term أصل, لا يحتاج, it doesn't require from us أن يتوقف فيه, that one withholds from it. It's not required that we stop. بل يمضي على الأصل, you can do it. You don't have to hold back. You can do it. Like for example, as we mentioned last time, al-asl fil awani al-tahara, the asl for utensils is purification. You don't have to stop and withhold and think about this utensil and ask questions. You can use it. You can go forward and use that utensil until proven otherwise. Number two, and al-mutamassik, the one who's holding on to bil asli, who's holding on to the qa'idatul mustamirra, who's holding on to the asl, la yutalabu bid-dalil, he's never requested for evidence. No one can ask you evidence because you're on the default position. You don't need to bring evidence. You're upon the qa'idatul mustamirra. You're upon the continuous evidence. And we're going to see that later, inshallah ta'ala. Like for example, al-asru fil ibadah al-man'a. The asl for ibadah is prohibition. You're not allowed to do an ibadah. The asr is you can't, unless you have evidence for it. And then if a person says, you're not allowed to do this ibadah to someone, he's right. The one who's doing it needs to bring the evidence, because he's going against the asl. Not the one who's saying that you can't do ibadah, because the asl is that you can't do ibadah. Okay? And the opposite is al-'adah. Aada, which is norms. Norms, on the other hand, aadat, the asal is what? The asal is, we're going to mention that later, inshallah ta'ala. The asal for that is that it's permissible. Al-ibaha. So since the asal for it is al-ibaha, the one who is doing something in their aada, in their norms, he or she doesn't have to provide evidence. The one who's saying that you can't do it needs to bring the evidence. So you see, you learn who should bring the evidence and who shouldn't. So if you're holding on to the asal, لا يطالب بالدليل. No one can ask you for evidence. لذلك, you find somebody going out of his way, trying to find evidence for something he or she shouldn't have to find evidence for. It's not even upon you to find the evidence. The person who's telling you, bring the evidence, they're the ones who have to bring the evidence. But the reason why the person would go and look for evidence is because he or she doesn't know that the asal is evidence for them. Number three is أن القاعدة, that the قاعدة أما الأصل, that the person is holding on to, it is made a mizan, it's made a scaling for a ruling, إذا صدرت بالأصل, when it is used with the word asal. We use this as a scaling machine for any issues that come to us. Like for example, al-aslu fil buyu'i al-ibaha, the asal of transaction, financial transaction, is permissibility. Okay, a transaction comes to us. By default, this transaction is permissible. Unless there comes an evidence and prohibits it. We're using this as a scaling machine. And we're scaling every transaction that comes to us. That's the third benefit. The fourth benefit is, أَنَّ حِفْظَ الْأَصْلِ, memorizing the asal, يُغْنِي عَنْ حِفْظِ الْجُزْئِيَاتِ. If you memorize the asal of things, it will suffice you from having to memorize all of the juz'iyat or the furu', the sub branches. Like, if you study fiqh book and every single chapter that you're going to study, you memorize the asal for it. You're in tahara, you study the asal for everything, every chapter, every bab, the asal for it. Salah, the same asal. And you go to had everything, you do the asal. What's it gonna protect you from having to memorize so much juz'iyat? It's gonna help you from that. And the hifz al-asl, just memorizing the asal in issues, what does it help you? Yughni an hifz al-juz'iyat, it will suffice you from what? It will suffice you from having to memorize so many sub-branches. Number five is أن كلمة الأصل, the term الأصل في أول القاعدة, the term الأصل that's in the beginning of the principle, the قاعدة. For example, now الأصل في البيوع الإباحة, we have at the beginning what? الأصل. It's the beginning. It's in the beginning of the principle. What does it give us? It tells us تشعرك بأنه قد يترك, that you're allowed to leave it if you want to, that it's not an obligation, that it's not a obligation, and that it's also something that could be left. For example, when the scholars say الأصل براءة الذمة, the asal is innocency for a person. Yes, that's the asal. But sometimes the asal can be left. So it shows us that the asal is not always implemented. There are istithna'at, there are exceptions in it. That's what the word asal gives us. that there can be times when there it can be gone against. That's also another benefit that we get in it. Now we're going to go into the next part of the definition of the qa'ida, which is al-ibaha. Okay, we mentioned al-asl, we defined it linguistically and technically. We also spoke about the benefit of learning asl. We're now going to go to al-ibaha. What does ibaha mean? Al-ibaha in the Arabic language, it means al-itlaq wal-idhn wal-idhar, which basically means permission. It means to permit something, to make something apparent, to unrestrict something. That's what it means in the language. The technical definition, اصطلاح العلماء, the usage of the scholars. And when the scholars use the word al-ibaha, what do they mean by it? فَهِيَ الْإِذْنُ بِالتَّرْكِ وَالْفِعْلِ عَلَىٰ حَدٍ سَوَاءٍ بِالنَّصْ أَوِ السُّكُوتِ. The word ibaha, according to the scholars, is the permission to either do something or leave off something. You're allowed to do it if you want to, and you're allowed to stay away from it and leave it off. But in what way? Like in ala haddin sawa, equally. The way that you're allowed to do it and the way that you're allowed to leave it are both the same, 50-50. And where did you find out that you doing it and you leaving it off is the same? Either bin nasi, a textual evidence gave you that permission, said to you, you could either do it or leave it. Or you took it from a sukut, the fact that the sharia didn't speak about it. The fact that the sharia did not talk about this issue, you took from that, you can do it or you can leave it, ala haddin sawa, in an equal manner. Like in some of the scholars, they do ta'aqib of this issue, meaning they say that sahih, ibaha, it does mean ما أذن في فعله أو تركه على حد سواء بالنص. They said, نعم, مباح does mean that which you have been permitted to do or to leave equally by textual evidence. They said that's what mubah means. And al-afu, al-afu, it means ma adhina al-shari'a, that which the legislator permitted fi fi'li, in doing it, aw tarki, or leaving it off, bis-sukuti anhu, by not textually stating it. So they said that mubah and afu, the difference between the two is, okay, that the mubah is textually stated, that you're allowed to do it or leave it equally, whereas the afu, the sharia permitted for you to do it or to leave it off, not textually, by not speaking about it, is where you took it from. They said that's the difference between mubah and afu. And some scholars, they say, no, it both is mubah. But both of them are ma'dhunu shara. It's that which the sharia permitted. And it's those two types, mubah and afu. And the evidence that they use to say that they're both different is the hadith al-Imam al-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah narrated min hadithi Salman. And the wording that I'm mentioning here is the wording of al-Imam al-Bayhaqi rahimahullah, mentions in his Sunan al-Kubra, and Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah graded this hadith to be hasan, which is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, al-halalu ma ahallallah fi kitabi. The halal is that which Allah permitted in his book. وَالْحَرَامُ مَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهِ. And the haram is that which Allah prohibited في كتابه, in his book. وَمَا سَكَتَ عَنْهُ فَهُوَ عَفْوٌ. And anything that Allah was silent about, it is afu. So the mubah and the afu here are being mentioned separately. And where's the mubah? The mubah is the first part, which is الْحَلَالُ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ فِي كِتَابِهِ. That's mubah. The halal is that which Allah permitted in his book. So the mubah is what? ما أذن في فعله أو تركه على السواء بالنص. It's been mentioned textually. الحلال ما أحل الله في كتابه. And the عفو is what? وما سكت عنه فهو عفو. And عفو is what? ما أذن الشارع في فعله أو تركه على حد سواء بالسكوت عنه. By being silent about it. By being silent about it. Now we're going to go into the meaning of the qa'idah. What does this qa'idah now mean? What is the meaning of the qa'idah? معنى القاعدة, the meaning of the qa'idah is which qa'idah? الأصل في البيوع الإباحة. The asl of buyu is what? Permissibility. The meaning of this is أن القاعدة المستمرة, the continuous principle is في البيوع, in transaction, الإذن وعدم المنع. It is permission and not prohibition. That's what it means. أن القاعدة المستمرة, the continuous principle في البيوع, in transaction, is الإذن, permission, وعدم المنع, and not prohibition. So look what we've done right now. We took out the word al-asr, and we took out the word al-what? Al-ibaha, and we put the meanings of both of them in there. What did we say al-ibaha, what did we say al-asr meant? Al-qa'idat al-mustamirra. So we exchanged it with it. What did we say al-ibaha meant? We said it meant al-idhn wa adam al-manah. It is to permit something and not prohibit it. So we changed the word al-ibaha with what? Its meaning, which is al-idhnu wa adam al-manah. So it became أن القاعدة المستمرة في البيوع الإذن وعدم المنع. That the continuous principle in transaction, of a financial transaction, is الإذن. It is الإذن وعدم المنع. And it is not prohibition. So we said the meaning of the قاعدة is أن القاعدة المستمرة في البيوع الإذن وعدم المنع. That the continuous principle regarding financial transaction is permissibility and not prohibition. What does that entail? That entails that it is not obligatory on a Muslim أن يتوقف في بيع من البيوع, that he has to withhold from a particular transaction. No. He's allowed to do any transaction he wishes, إلا إذا علم في ذلك مانعا شرعيا, unless he finds out that in the Sharia, this transaction is prohibited. The Quran, it shows and it supports this principle. It shows and supports this principle. The Quran. And so does the Sunnah. And there's also the ijma' of the Ummah in this issue. And I'm going to bring the ijma' of three scholars. I'm going to mention three scholars who brought ijma'. I'm not going to quote them. And the first one is Al-Imam Ibn Qudama, and then Al-Imam Al-Nawawi, and Al-Imam Ibn Hajar. And we will discuss this ijma' inshallah ta'ala. Where is it in the Quran that al-asl fi al-buyu'i al-ibaha? Amma anna al-qa'idat al-mustamirra fi al-buyu'i al-idhn wa adam al-man'a. The evidence for that is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 275, where Allah says, wa ahallallahu al-bay'a وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَى وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ. Allah has permitted subhanahu wa ta'ala البيعه Allah permitted بيع وحرم الربا and he Allah سبحانه وتعالى he has prohibited الربا. The scholars, they use this ayah as the evidence that financial transaction is permissible until proven otherwise. Where did they extract the ruling from? They took it from the ayah where it says, وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ Allah has permitted الْبَيْعَ. If you look at the word al-bay'a, it's what? It's an ism mufrad. It's a singular noun. The plural is al-buyu', as we mentioned. Al-buyu' is what? It's a plural. And the singular is what? Bay'a. Al-bay'a. The qa'idah, according to the scholars, is al-ism al-mufrad, a singular noun. إِذَا أُدْخِلَ عَلَيْهِ أَلِفُ وَاللَّامِ If Alif Al-Lam is entered into it, اِقْتَضَ الْعُمُومِ It shows generalization. That's why Abdulrahman Nasir al-Sa'idi says in his قَوَاعِدِ الْفِقِيَّةِ وَالْأَلْ تُفِيدُ الْكُلُّ فِي الْعُمُومِ فِي الْجَمْعِ وَالْإِفْرَادِ كَالْعَلِيمِ That it shows generalization. So here it means وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ Allah has permitted all of buyu'. Where do we get the word all of buyu'? Because the word al-hiya has been placed into an isim mufrad, iqtada al-umumi, it has necessitated and it has brought about generalization. It's like the al inside the statement of Allah, wal-asri, innal insana, al-insan. That alif al-lam in al-insan, al-insan is a what? It's an isim mufrad. أُدِخِلَ عَلَيْهِ الْأَلِفُ وَاللَّامِ اِقْتَضَ الْعُمُومِ So he said, جِنْسُ الْإِنسَانِ All of mankind is upon misguidance. Except those Allah mentioned after that. So that's what the scholars used. And that's the first evidence for the qa'idah. The second evidence that they used is The ayah in Surah An-Nisa, ayah 29, where Allah says, إِلَّا أَن تَكُونَ تِجَارَةً عَن تَرَاضٍ مِّنْكُمْ Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He permitted here, تِجَارَةً عَن تَرَاضٍ Financial transaction that is done with تَرَاضٍ That is done with initial agreement on both sides. Both parties are pleased with one another. فَالْأَصْلُ فِي التِّجَارَةِ الْوَاقِعَةِ The asl from the transaction that happens between the two people, it is permissibility. And that it is مُبَاحَ إِلَّا مَا دَلَّ الدَّلِيلُ عَلَى مَنْعِهِ Except that which the evidence show that it's prohibited. وَلِذَلِكَ you know the famous hadith that Ibn Hibban and Ibn Majah narrated That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّمَا الْبَيْعُ عَنْ تَرَاضٍ إِنَّمَا الْبَيْعُ عَنْ تَرَاضٍ That financial transaction is based upon تَرَاضٍ That both parties are pleased with one another. And if you look at the word, إِنَّمَا is what's being used here. إِنَّمَا has shown what? حَصْرُ الْبَيْعُ Exclusivity. In other words, the Prophet is saying, Final transaction is nothing except, okay, that the two people are pleased with one another. So whenever the two parties are pleased with one another, then this is what? فَالْأَصْلُ فِي الْبَيْعَ أَنَّهُ جَائِزٌ That the asl is that the bay is permissible unless there comes a textual evidence that prohibits it. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to do financial transaction. عليه الصلاة والسلام ولذلك أي مان جاء رجل مشعان أي مان came scruffy hair and he was a tall man وهو يسوق and he was with him was غنم he had sheep goats and lambs فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم the prophet said to him alayhi salatu wasalam, is this, are you selling this or are you giving it as out as a gift? The Prophet asked him. And then the man said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, bayah, I'm selling it. Fashtara minhu sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and then the Prophet bought from him alayhi salatu wasalam. So he bought it, business, financial transaction. وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ, also from the evidence that support this qa'ida, is the salaf al-salih, the pious predecessors who we were commanded to follow. وَعَلَى رَأْسِهِمْ, and the forefront of the salaf is the companions. كَانُوا يَتَبَايَعُونَ, the sahabas would buy and sell from one another. And they would buy and sell from others. مِنْ غَيْرِ تَوَقُّفٍ, without withholding. And this shows that أن الأصل في البيوع الإباحة. Even at the time of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Sahabas لم يكن الصحابة يرجعون إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في كل بيع. The Sahabas would not come to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم with every transaction that they did. They wouldn't. They wouldn't say, يا رسول الله, today I bought and I sold this. Is it permissible or is it not? They wouldn't. And this is an indication to what? أن الأصل في البيوع الإباحة, the أصل that is permissible, if it was haram, then it would have come an evidence that was prohibiting them from it. So they used to do every transaction unless there comes an evidence that prevented them from it. فَكَانُوا يَتَعَاقَدُونَ بِدُونِ رُجُوعٍ إِلَى النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So they would do their transaction, they would buy and they would sell without referring back to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم in every single transaction that they did. Why? Because the asal is permissibility. Because the asal is permissibility. Here there's a question now. Is there a consensus in this particular issue? Do the scholars unanimously agree upon that? Na'am. Great noble scholars, they transmitted consensus. From them is, as I mentioned, Ibn Qudama in his Kitab Al-Mughni, which is the Sharh Al-Mukhtasar Al-Khiraqi. Al-Imam Al-Nawwi, Abi Zakariya Al-Nawawi in his Majmu' and in other places of his books. And also Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala, he brings an ijma' in his Kitab Fathul Bari, the fourth volume, page 287. He says, وَأَجْمَعَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ عَلَى جَوَازِ الْبَيْعِ وَالْحِكْمَةُ تَقْتَضِيهِ لِأَنَّ حَاجَةَ الْإِنسَانِ تَتَعَلَّقُ بِمَا فِي يَدِ صَاحِبِهِ غَالِبًا وصاحبه قد لا يبذله له ففي تشريع البيع وسيلة إلى بلوغ الغرض من غير حرج. He says, وأجمع المسلمون, the Muslims are unanimously in agreement على جواز البيع, that buying and selling is permissible. والحكمة تقتضيه, the wisdom necessitates this. This is logic, it's wisdom, you can understand that. Why? لأن حاجة الإنسان تتعلق بما في يد صاحبه غالبا. That my need is most of the times connected to something that's in the hand of somebody else. I, for example, need a product that this person has in his hand. And he needs the money that's in my hand. If bay' was not made permissible, I would rob it from him. And he would rob it from me. That's what would happen. Because there's no other way to take it from him. It's three ways that you can take from a person. It's either debt, or you can steal it from the person, or you can buy and sell it from the person. The one that the Sharia pushes towards is buying and selling. Robbing and stealing from people's wealth, this is why it's prohibited. Also, the third one, which is taking debt, that the Sharia also looked down at that. It's to avoid it. So the best and the greatest way is to buy that product from them. So he takes what you want. And you take what you want. وَصَاحِبُ قَدْ لَا يَبْذُلُهُ لَهُ فَفِي تَشْرِيعِ الْبَيْعِ وَسِيلَةٌ إِلَى بُلُوغِ الْغَرَضِ مِنْ غَيْرِ حَرَجٍ. That's the kalam of Imam Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala in Fathul Bari. Here the question is, we have consensus of these scholars, but is there consensus regarding the aslul bay'i, the asl of bay'? Or what is it? Pay attention to this. The ulama are unanimously in agreement, as I mentioned before. Ibn Qudam, al-Nawawi, Ibn Hajar, other than them. ولذلك Ibn Hajar used the word أَجْمَعَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ, the Muslims, all of them. أَنَّ الْبَيْعَ الَّذِي وَرَدَ فِيهِ نَصْ مُبَحْ, that bay is three types. The ones that there are textual evidence for that transaction, meaning it's textually stated, they are not disputing one another on that one. They are also not disputing وَأَنَّ الْبَيْعَ الَّذِي وَرَدَ عَنْهُ النَّهِي is مَمْنُوعٌ. The second one is financial transactions which the Sharia prohibited. Okay? They are also unanimously in agreement that these are prohibited. Okay? The dispute is, and the argument is, what about the transactions which the Sharia was silent about? مَا سَكَتَ عَنْهُ الشَّارِعَ, the financial transaction which the Sharia, okay, which the Sharia went silent about, what is the ruling regarding that? The Jumhur Ahl al-Ilm, the overwhelming majority of scholars, they say al-aslu fil buyu' al-ibaha, as we mentioned, that the al-qa'idat al-mustamirra, the continuous principle is fil buyu' in financial transaction is al-idhn wa adam al-mana. That's the qawl of the Jumhur Ahl al-Ilm. Here we have lakin the Zahiriya. The Zahiriya, what do they believe? They believe the opposite. They believe ma sakata anhu shari', it is not al-ibaha. So the Jumhur al-Madahib al-Arba'a and kathir min salaf al-Ummah, they are of anna al-asla fil buyu' al-ibaha. Okay? And that is what's sahih. That is what is sahih. We've spoken about in our discussion, we mentioned the qa'ida number one. We define the terms that are in the qa'ida, like al-aslu and al-ibaha. We spoke about the benefit that is in what? The benefit that is in knowing this qa'ida, or knowing asl. Okay? The asl of things. The qa'ida to mustamirra of things. The benefits that are in it. We mentioned that. Number four, we mentioned the meaning of the qa'ida. What does the qa'ida mean? Number five, we started adillatul qa'ida, the evidence for the qa'ida. We mentioned what evidence? We mentioned al-adillatul juz'iyyah, the specific evidence. Where did we take it from? Al-kitabu wa sunnah wa al-ijma'. Now we're going to go into al-adillatul kulliyyah, the comprehensive evidences to support this qa'ida. And what are they going to be? Three other qa'ida, three other principles that aid and support this principle, which is al-aslu fil buyu' al-ibaha, ta qa'ida, three other qa'ida that aid it and support it. The first one is anna al-asla fil ashya' an-nafi'ah al-ibaha. There are three other qa'ids that are going to aid it, which is what? Okay? أن الأصل في الأشياء the القاعدة المستمرة, the continuous principle regarding things that are beneficial is permissibility. Something is beneficial for the people. The قاعدة المستمرة is what? The قاعدة المستمرة is الإذن وعدم المنع, that is permissible and it's not prohibited. Good. And the evidence that shows that is قوله تعالى, the statement of Allah, هو الذي خلق لكم ما في الأرض جميعا. Allah is the one who created for you everything that is on the face of this earth. Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 29. هو الذي, Allah is the one. What did He do? هو الذي خلق لكم. He's the one who created for you. What did He create for us? ما في الأرض جميعا. Everything that's on this earth. He created it for us. So this ayah has indicated that the asl for every single thing is permissibility. How has it shown it? In two ways. In two ways that the ayah has shown it. Okay, and al-asl fi al-ashya an-nafi'a al-ibaha. Two ways. Number one, Allah here is mentioning His favors on us, that He created for us everything on the face of this earth. He's mentioning a favor that He's done for us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that shows and it indicates that it's permissibility, because the favor wouldn't be something I prohibited you from. If you look at Surah Saba, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? لَقَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَئٍ فِي مَسْكَنِهِمْ آيَةٍ جَنَّتَانِ عَنْ يَمِينِ وَالشِّمَالِ كُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِ رَبِّكُمْ. Eat from the provision of your Lord, meaning everything is permissible for you, go and eat from it. So the fact that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is mentioning a favor here of making favor that He's bestowed upon us, it would mean that He's talking about the permissibility of everything that's on the face of this earth, that He hasn't prohibited us from it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second way in which the ayah indicates is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ. هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ. The لَكُمْ, if you look at the lam in the word هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ, this lam is called لَامُ الْمِلْكِ, the lam of ownership. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He created everything on this earth, وَمَلَّكَنَا إِيَّهِ, and He has placed it in our possession. He's given us ownership of it. So this means that we are permitted to benefit from it and utilize it. إِلَّا مَا مَنَعَ مِنْهُ الشَّرَعَ, except that which the Sharia prohibited. So those are the two ways in which the ayah indicates that أَنَّ الْأَصْلَ فِي الْأَشْيَاءِ النَّافِعَةِ الْإِبَاحَةِ. ولذلك حديث الإمام البخاري and Muslim both narrated, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, إن أعظم المسلمين جرما, the Muslims, within the Muslims, the one who has the greatest sin, within the Muslims, the one who has the greatest sin is من سأل عن شيء, the one who asks about an issue, لم يحرم فحرم من أجل مسألته, and then it gets prohibited due to his questioning. It wasn't haram, it was permissible, and then it gets prohibited due to his asking. So pay attention here. It was permissible in the beginning, that's what it means. And it was allowed. But he asked, and now it became prohibited. This was talking about the time of the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, when the revelation was coming down. So the person was, the Sahabas were prohibited from asking the Prophet too many questions. You all know the famous hadith in Bukhari that the Anas ibn Malik, he said, we were prohibited from asking any questions. فَكَانَ يُعْجِبُنَا, it used to fascinate us that a Bedouin man would come and ask a good question on our behalf. Because the Bedouins weren't with the Prophet and they wouldn't know about the prohibition. So they would come from far and they would just ask the question. We weren't allowed to. So here, what we take from this is, why would it be made haram? Unless it was in the beginning what? Unless it was permissible in the beginning. The second qa'ida kulliya, the second comprehensive evidence that supports this principle, which is al-aslu fil buyu' al-ibaha, is anna al-bay'a min al-'adat. That the bay' is from what? The bay' is from the customs and it's from the norms. And the qa'idah for that is أن الأصل في العبادات المنع والأصل في العادات الإباحة. That the أصل in عبادات is what? Prohibition. توقف. You're not allowed to do it. والأصل في العادات, and the أصل of عادات, عادات means what? Norms and customs, is what? الإباحة. Or it's al-idhn, permission, permissibility. Bay'ah, does it fall under ibadat or does it fall under adat? Bay'ah falls under adat. I mentioned that in the beginning, and al-bay'ah min al-adat, that the buying and the selling is from the norms. Okay, it's from the norms. And since it's from the adat, then, okay, It is al-idhnu, the permissibility is asr. What is it? It is permissible. And you're allowed to. Here now, I want to mention a very good benefit, which is ضابط العبادات and ضابط العادات. How do you distinguish ibadah from an ada? How do you distinguish an ibadah from an ada? And how can one know from the one from the other? Adat, okay, adat is maqsooduha is ukhrawiyyah. The intent behind it and the objective behind it is the hereafter. This is what? Ibadat, sorry. That's ibadat. Ibadat, maqsooduha, its ultimate goal is ukhrawi. It's the hereafter. Whereas the adat, maqsooduha, its intent is al-a'zam, it's dunyawi. It's this dunya. For example, a ibadah, you don't do it for a maqsood dunyawi, you don't. You can't say I'm fasting in the month of Ramadan to lose weight. You can't. It's not permissible for you. You can't say I pray Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha as an exercise. It's a form of fitness. You're not allowed to. Because these ibadat, maqsooduha, the intent behind it is ukhrawi, it's an ibadah. Whereas the adat, the ultimate goal from the adat is what? Dunyawi, it's worldly. But a person can intend the adat, he can come with the intent of akhirah and getting reward from Allah Azza wa Jalla. But the objective from it is not the akhirah, it's this dunya. When you're buying and you're selling, you're doing it because of your worldly need. You're doing it for your worldly need. Okay? That's the dhabit. And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah in his kitab, Al-Qawa'id al-Nuraniyah, he goes more in details regarding this. And what's the difference between al-riya and qasdu maslahat dunyawiyya? Some may say, oh, this is confusing me here. You're saying that the adat is intending the dunya. So you need to distinguish between intending something, the dunya from something, or showing off. Is it the same? It's showing off. And having a worldly intent behind it, are they both the same? That is not the case. So look more into that issue. In Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah's Qawa'id al-Nuraniyyah and other scholars speak about it in great details. The third evidence, the third qa'idah kulliyah that supports this principle that we're talking about today, which is al-aslu fil buyu' al-ibaha, is anna al-shari'ata ja'at bil-yusri. Our religion, what has it come with? It has come with al-yusri. Before I go into the third one, we all know the famous line of Sheikh Abdulrahman Nasir al-Sa'diyu, where he says, وَالْأَصْلُ فِي عَادَاتِنَا الْإِبَاحَ حَتَّى يَجِيءَ صَارِفُ الْإِبَاحَ, which is to support the second one that I mentioned, which is al-aslu fi al-adati al-idhna, am al-ibaha. Sa'di rahimahullah, he says, وَالْأَصْلُ فِي عَادَاتِنَا الْإِبَاحَ حَتَّى يَجِيءَ صَارِفُ الْإِبَاحَ. The third one is أن الشريعة جاءت باليسري, that the Sharia came to make things easy. It came to make matters easy. If I have something, this person wants it, and it's in my hand, and they have something I want, and it's in their possession, and we can't take it from each other, then that would mean that the religion is making things hard. And it doesn't allow me to steal it from him. And it would only force me to take debt. That's the only channel that it would open for me. And debt means that this person would give it to me on debt. Okay? And then I would give it to him on debt. And our debt will not finish. Okay? It won't finish. So it'd be mashaqqa. And Ahmad Nasir Saudi says in his Mandhuma, قاعدة الشريعة تيسير في كل أمر نابه تعصير. That the قاعدة الشريعة is what? The principle of our religion is إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. يريد الله أن يخفف عنكم. Allah wants to make things easy on you. ما جعل عليكم في الدين من حرج. The religion wasn't made hard on us. So Allah wants to make things easy for us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's yusr, it's ease, simplicity. So these three qawa'id, what does it support? Al-aslu fil buyu' al-ibaha. The Quran supports it, we mentioned it, the Sunnah supports it, the ijma' of the scholars support it, and these three qawa'id kulliya support it. We're now going to move on to, inshallah ta'ala, after finishing adillatul qa'ida, we're going to now move on to the last point today, which is ba'du buyu'il muta'alliqati fi hadha. We're going to mention some transactions that are connected to this. Contemporary transactions, contemporary financial transactions that people do that are connected to or that we should know, inshallah ta'ala, that are connected to this particular chapter, which is Al-Aslu fil Buyu' al-Ibaha. The first one is Bay'u al-Taqsit. What is Bay'u al-Taqsit? Bay'u al-Taqsit means payment in installment. It's the type of financial transaction where a person pays in installments. Bay'u al-Taqsit, the form and the ways that it has come is so much. But the most general form is بَيْعُ السِّلْعَةٍ, is to sell a product بِثَمَنٍ مُؤَجَّلٍ مُنَجَّمٍ يعني مقسم على أَزْمِنَةٍ مُعَيَّنَةٍ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ ثَمَنِهَا الْحَاضِرِ. It is to sell a product بِثَمَنٍ مُؤَجَّلٍ مُنَجَّمٍ. You're selling a product, you're giving out a product on a later timing. You're going to delay. You're going to give a product with the price that the person has to pay is a what? Delayed. So I'm going to say to you, this is my phone. Okay, this phone of mine is the sil'ah, it's a product I'm selling. Take it. You are now going to take this phone بِثَمَنٍ مُؤَجَّلٍ. You're not going to pay now. You don't have to give me the money now. You give me the money, small installments over a period of time. Now the issue here is this permissible? Is it permissible? Keeping in mind, there is a what? There is a price that you need. You can buy it now if you want. You can take the phone. Or what you can also do is, you can pay in installments. What's the difference? The price that it costs to pay now is cheaper than if you pay in what? In installment. So if the phone costs, for example, 5,000 dirhams now. If you pay in installments, it's going to cost you 10,000 dirhams. And you pay it within a year. This is called bay'u taqsid. It's payment in installment. What is the ruling regarding it? If we look at bay'u taqsid, we will say bay'u taqsid is mubah. It's permissible. Why? لِأَنَّ الْأَصْلَ فِي الْبُيُوعِ الْإِبَاحَةِ. We're using the qa'ida, which is the asal of financial transaction is what? It's permissibility. That's it. But what we have to understand is two things have to be in place. Two things have to be present for that type of transaction not to be haram. Two things have to be found. Two things have to be present. The first one is أن تكون السلعة مما لا يشترط فيه القبض في المجلس. This thing has to be from this product cannot be from those products that you have to sell on the spot, and there has to be selling and taking on the spot. There are some products in our religion that you cannot delay. Sharia doesn't allow it. It forces what is known as qabd. It won't even allow debt. Sharia doesn't allow debt on it. And that is, for example, al-dhahab wal-fidda. You're not allowed to do that. You can't say to a person, that gold? Okay, good. I'll pay you some now, and I'll pay you some tomorrow. And give me the gold. That you're not allowed to. The gold is, you pay, and he gives it to you straight away. ولذلك, you're not even allowed to buy and sell gold online. The reason is because there has to be what? There has to be qabd. Here's the money, here's the product. خلاص. So bay'u taqsit is not allowed to be done with the sil'ah, a product which the sharia conditioned al-qabdu fil majlisi, that the person needs to take in the sit, in that place. Okay? Like gold and fidda, they are conditioned, okay, al-qabdu fil majlisi, that it has to be taken on the spot. The second condition is أن يكون الثمن مستقرا. The price for the بيع التقسيط has to be restricted. It has to be affirmed. It has to be stated. If it's not مستقر, خرج عن القاعدة, it doesn't fall under our principle, which is الأصل في البيوع الإذن. What does this mean? It means a person says to a person, I'm going to sell you my car, or I'm going to sell you my phone. If you take it for a year, if you're going to pay this in a year, 1 year, in a duration of 1 year, it's going to cost you 6,000. Okay? If you pay it in 3 years, it's going to cost you 8,000. If you take it for 4 years, it's going to cost you 10,000. So it's 2,000 each time, adding on. And the actual price right now is 5,000. The person says, قَبِلْتُ, I accept, وَتَمَّ الْعَقْدُ, and they agree on it. This person who's taking it on this side, and the one who's giving it, they haven't mentioned which one it's going to be. Is he going to pay it in 3 years? 1 year? Is he going to pay it in 3 years, or is he going to pay it in 4 years? No one agreed. It's all based upon this man. Whenever he pays, this man is just taking. This one, the amount is not restricted, meaning they haven't chosen a duration with the money, and this is prohibited. And it does fall under, Sheikh Al-Bani rahimahullah mentioned here, Al-Bay'atayni fi bay'a. It becomes two transactions in one transaction. That's prohibited in Sharia. Lakin, okay, if he says, in that same situation, if he says, listen, how many choices have you given me? He says, I gave you 1 year, 3 years, or 4 years. He goes, okay, I take the 1 year. And they agree based on that 1 year. That's permissible. Because the bay' now has become mustaqir. The price has now become restricted. They've narrowed it down. They've mentioned it. Before it was what? It was nothing. It was. So those are the two conditions. The first condition was what? أن تكون السلعة مما لا يشترط فيه القبض في المجلس. That this product cannot be from the products that the Sharia conditioned for it to be taken on the spot. If it is, bay' al-taqsit is not allowed on that. The second is, أن يكون الثمن مستقرا. That money has to be what? Narrowed down. You need to know what's the duration you're going to pay, and that, how much does it cost? That has to be agreed upon. The couple of offers that are out there, he has to restrict himself to one of them. He has to restrict himself and he has to agree with the seller with that. That's bay'u at-taqsit. What did we do in bay'u at-taqsit? We mentioned that generally speaking, bay'u at-taqsit is what? Mubah. When he meets those two conditions. If those two conditions are not in there, or one of them is missing, what did we say is? خرج عن القاعدة. It leaves the قاعدة. Which قاعدة? الأصل في الإباحة. الأصل في البيوع الإباحة. It's no longer that قاعدة anymore. Now we're going to go into the second type of بيع. The second type of the بيوع المعاصرة. One of the most well-known بيوع now. Contemporary بيوع. Which is known as بيع المرابحة. Is known as what? بيع المرابحة. What is بيع المرابحة? بيع المرابحة is someone buys an item. This is the original meaning. Someone buys an item for a certain price. And then he sells it to another person for the original price plus an extra amount of profit. So it means someone buys an item for a certain price. A person buys a product for a certain price. Then he sells it to another person for the original price plus extra amount of profit. Both in which are known. The original price is known and the extra amount of profit is also known that he put on this. The asal for this is what? Al-ibaha. Okay? The asal for this is what? Al-ibaha. It falls under the qa'idah that we mentioned, which is al-asal fil buyu'i al-ibaha. That the qa'idah mustamirrah, the continuous principle regarding transaction, financial transaction, is permissibility. That's what it falls under. But today we find within banks a بيع المرابحة, which they call بيع المرابحة للآمر بالشراء. What they call بيع المرابحة للواعد بالشراء. Which is بيع المرابحة. بيع المرابحة, الإمام الشافعي speaks about in كتاب الأم. What does it mean بيع المرابحة للواعد بالشراء؟ أما بيع المرابحة للآمر بالشراء. What does it mean? It means selling by installments to the one who issued instruction for you to buy it for them. I'll explain what it means. A person goes to a bank and he says to the bank, I want a car. Okay? I want a car and I'm going to pay installments. Pay installments. The car that I want, its description is this. Or he even may point towards a car and say, look, that's the car I want. It's in that showroom, that company own it, and it's that car. This is the details of the car. Then the bank says to the person, okay, I will buy it for you. I'll go to the showroom and I'll buy it. You're going to pay installments. Yes. He goes, okay, agree. And they leave each other. Did the bank own the car? Did the bank own the car? Is it under the ownership of the bank? No. The bank goes now, knowing that they've been sent by somebody. Now they go and they buy the car for this person. And then what they do is, of course, they add their price onto it. So there's an original price, which they buy from the showroom. And there's also what? Huh? There's also going to be a extra profit of amount in which the bank is going to put on it. Pay attention to this. This one, it's called بيع المرابحة. This is not permissible. The reason is because, number one, these two individuals agreed and they had an initial agreement on something that the bank doesn't even own. Okay? So the bank is selling to him بَاعَ مَا لَا يَمْلِكُ. The bank is selling to you what it doesn't own and it doesn't possess. So from that angle, it leaves our qa'ida. Point number two is that if it wasn't an agreement. In other words, the bank and you did not agree on this. What does it mean that you didn't agree? The bank did not take from you any money. No advance payment. Or even if they try to call it masarif idariya, administration fee. Or they take from you, or you sign a contract that when they bring this car, that it's going to be yours. You don't sign any contract. Nor do you pay any administration fee. Nor do you pay any deposit. Nothing. But the bank just promises you that they're going to get the car for you. Just a mere promise. And when the car comes, you're allowed to withhold, you're allowed to change your mind and say, I don't want this transaction anymore. If that is the case, then this is called bay'ul murabahati lil wa'id bishira, and it's permissible. Because the bank is promising you and it's not sold anything to you. They're telling you, don't worry, we'll get that car. Would you like that car? Yes, we'll get it for you. You're both not agreeing on anything. You're not paying any money in advance. No deposit. You're not signing no contract. You're not paying no administration fee. Nothing is being taken from you, and nothing is made, and you're not made to sign anything. And you're not made to sign no contract, no nothing. Good. Pay attention to this. And it's just a wa'ad, a promise from on the side of the bank that they'll bring you this car. When the car arrives, shar'an you are permitted to say, I don't no longer want this, because it's a new transaction. When the car comes, it's a total new transaction. That I can now say to the bank, I no longer want this car. And that the bank accepts that. If that's the case, then this is bay'ul murabahati lil wa'id bishira'i, and it's permissible. There's nothing wrong with that. But the overwhelming majority of banks don't do that. They'll take a deposit from you. They'll make you sign a contract and they'll say you have to be in this. When the car comes, it's automatically yours. Because they don't want to lose out. That's number two. Or they say to you, look, the money that we took from you, sorry, it's just all it is administration fee. There was nothing. Whatever good name that they try to give it, the qa'idah is that it's what? It is impermissible. What is it? It is impermissible. And you're not allowed to do that. Does that make sense? We're now going to go into the third, which is bay'ul ashum. What's the ruling on buying shares in a company? All of these are what? We're going over it very fast because we have a lot of qawa'id to do. And many of them may come back again. Ruling on buying shares in a company. A share is a specific part of the total capital of a company. A person, he's buying a share of the total capital of a company. Now we're talking about a company that exists, a company that has value. We're not talking about a company that doesn't exist and has no value. Okay? And the reality of shares is that it is أنها قابلة للبيع. You can buy and you can sell it. It's like a product now. What is shares? Shares is what? It's like a product. You have to understand that. So according to the Jumhur Ahl al-Ilmi, is that, we're talking about the contemporary scholars, since it's مقابلة للبيع, you can buy and you can sell it, they looked at it as a سلعة, as a product. So they said it's يجوز البيع الأسهم. Selling, buying shares is permissible. And what do they use? Al-aslu fil buyu'i al-ibaha. But the scholars, the muhaqiquna min ahli al-ilmi, these are the grounded, noble, righteous scholars, they divided the bay'ul aswum. They divided buying specific shares of a total company, of a total capital of a company, they divided those companies into three in terms of its ruling. When you learn each of the company, then you learn, are you allowed to? The asal is permissibility. It's like buying and selling products. But the companies are three types in which you're trying to buy shares from. The first type is sharikat naqiyya, companies which are pure. When we say pure, it's two things it's pure from. Amaluha mubah, the things that are being done in this company is permissible. وَتَمْوِيلُهَا مُبَاح, and the aid and support and the financial aid is permissible. What do we mean by the things that they are doing and what they're selling is permissible? For example, they sell meat, halal slaughtered meat. Okay? There's nothing wrong with it. What they're doing here is permissible. The second thing is, it's pure. Second thing is got, what has it got? The tamweel, where did they get the funds from? And they didn't get the funds from haram. It's their sweat, their blood, their efforts, or they collected it from people and made it into a company. So in other words, it wasn't taken from al-bunuk al-ribawiyya. They didn't take it from banks as interests. That would destroy the second part, which is the tamweel. The funds came from. This is the type which is called sharikat naqiyya. These ones you are allowed to invest in, and you're allowed to buy shares from. The second one is mukhtalita. It's mixed. What is it? It's mixed. How is it mixed? The things that are being sold is mubah. Okay? The amal and what they are doing is mubah. لكن تمويلها, the funds came from a bank and they took it on interest. They took it on what? They took it on interest from the bank. This one, it falls under the hadith, إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّنٌ وَإِنَّ الْحَرَامَ بَيِّنٌ وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ لَا يَعْلَمُهُنَّ كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ. It's a doubtful one. Stay away from it. Number three is muharrama, prohibited. Prohibited. This one, it's عَمَلُهَا وَتَمْوِيلُهَا. The things that are sold and where the funds were taken from, both are haram. They sell cigarettes. Okay? They sell alcohol. عَمَلُهَا مُحَرَّم. What they're doing is haram, aslan, what they're selling. And the funds were taken from banks. Okay? This one is haram and it's impermissible, and an individual is not allowed to buy stocks or shares from this type of company. You're not allowed to. Inshallah ta'ala, we're going to conclude there bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayhi.